From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Hello, and welcome to this JAMA podcast. I am Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA, and I'm here today with Dr. Usha Chakravarthy, who is an honorary and emeritus professor in the Center of Vision Science and Public Health at Queen's University of Belfast. Thank you so much for joining us today, Dr. Chakravarthy.
It's a great pleasure to be here with you today.
And we're going to be talking today about your narrative review in JAMA, which is on the topic of age-related macular degeneration. So first, I wondered if you could briefly summarize for our listeners, what is age-related macular degeneration?
Age-related macular degeneration is a disorder that mainly affects the central retina, the region we call the macula, and it occurs in older adults, and it has a progressively increase in prevalence with age, and hence we use the term age-related macular degeneration, in short, AMD. It is a degenerative process which occurs in key tissues in the macula. And these tissues are the outer regions of the neurosensory retina, comprising of the photoreceptors, the retinal pigment epithelium, which is the layer just opposed to the photoreceptors, and the innermost layer of the circulation of the eye, which is a choroid, which is known as the choroid capillaris. This block of tissues is critical for us if we are to see normally. And the region that AMD affects, which is the central macula, tends to start showing degenerative changes.
Your manuscript talks about the association of older age with increased prevalence, and I wondered if you could just summarize that for us. How common is this by age?
Below the age of 50, you normally don't see any signs of degeneration in the macula of eyes of people. Above 50, the earliest signs start to appear, consisting of small yellowish deposits, which we call drusen, and its prevalence is around 0.3 to 0.5%. So it's very, very low prevalence. As you get older, and once you get into your 60s and 70s, the prevalence increases. And by the time you're in your eighth decade of life, the prevalence increases to around 35%. So it's quite a high increase in these degenerative features that we term AMD.
How does it typically present? Does this typically present with symptoms, or is it something that an ophthalmologist would pick up during a normal eye exam or some combination of that?
Right. So AMD has a spectrum. So in the very early stages of AMD, when you just have small drusen scattered in the back of the eye in the retina, patients are generally asymptomatic. Therefore, it's not picked up and only seen if you go in for a routine eye check, either with your optometrist or your ophthalmologist. And it's fairly innocuous because the vast majority of people with these early changes are never going to run into any difficulties as they get older. But a proportion will progress over time to a stage which we call intermediate AMD, where the drusen get larger, the drusen burden increases in the macula, so it's a sheet of material collecting between the RPE and the neurosensory retina, and also these lumpy, bumpy collections, which are the large drusen, which start to press against the photoreceptors. And we can see them very easily on clinical examination. So when it gets to that stage, many patients will complain of a reduced ability to adapt from when they move from light conditions into more reduced lighting conditions, such as, you know, going into a cinema or into a dark room. They find it hard to adapt and find their way around obstacles. Subsequently, a proportion, probably around 5 to 10%, will develop a very late stage form of AMD, which is either geographic atrophy, regions of areas of the posterior pole of the eye, showing atrophy, that is all the tissue cells within these areas atrophying and dying, loss of food receptors, loss of RPE, and loss of the choroid capillaris, and or neovascularization. So this is a process whereby new blood vessels form arising from the choroid, penetrate through the barriers that are normally present, known as Bruch's membrane, into the region or the space between the retinal pigment epithelium and the retina, known as the subretinal space, and or into the retina itself when we call it a retinal angiomatous proliferation. So these new blood vessels can leak fluid and bleed, and we call that exudative or wet AMD. So the two late stage manifestations are associated with loss of central vision and their geographic atrophy and wet AMD.
What proportion of people with drusen will develop clinically important macular degeneration?
In the age-related eye diseases study, which was a very large trial that was carried out in the US and which enrolled people with a range of early AMD, intermediate AMD, which is a large drusen group, and people who had advanced AMD, either geographic atrophy or neovascular AMD in one eye and the other eye was followed up, there was a sort of a range of progression. So people who had very small drusen in both eyes had a very low risk of progression to late stage AMD. Those who had bilateral intermediate AMD of fairly severe nature, that is with a large number of drusen plus pigmentary changes in the macula, they progressed at a rate of around 25% over 5 years to late AMD, the very severe features. And when they had wet AMD in one eye, the other eye, there was a 50% chance of progression to late AMD.
What are the risk factors for age-related macular degeneration?
Well, there are modifiable risk factors, and the one that we always emphasize is cigarette smoking. So cigarette smoking increases your risk of progression to intermediate AMD from early AMD by twofold, and from intermediate AMD to late AMD about 3 to 4-fold. Other risk factors that are modifiable are obesity, which seems to play a role, cardiovascular disease, hypertension. Some of these also are associated with progression to more severe stages of AMD. The most important risk, though, is your genetics. Some 70% of the risk of AMD is coming from heritable causes. And we know in the past couple of decades, we've realized that there are certain genetic loci where there is a cluster of genes that increase risk of developing AMD very significantly.
I wonder if you could talk a little bit about prognosis once somebody is diagnosed.
So once AMD has been diagnosed, if the diagnosis has been made at a stage where the patient is at very high risk of progressing to late stage AMD, then the ARID style vitamins is generally recommended. But the risk reduction is around 8 to 10% in terms of absolute risk reduction. If the relative risk reduction is around 25%. So essentially, if you gave 100 people the ARID supplement over a period of 5 years, the chances of them developing wet AMD goes down from about 28%, those who got the placebo, to around 22% if they didn't get the placebo. So at around 1 in 16 are protected from progressing to late AMD.
And then how about treatments for age-related macular degeneration? Can you summarize those, please?
So if the patient has geographic atrophy, which is the atrophic form, there's still a lot of controversy about whether these patients should be treated with the latest developments in AMD therapeutics, which is inhibitors of complement activation. And this is the area where, you know, genetics has played a big role, where genes that encode complement have been shown to be strongly associated with the risk of developing AMD, and its activation of a particular pathway in complement known as the alternative pathway, which is triggered by chronic stress, oxidative stress. And patients who carry these high-risk polymorphisms have been known to develop AMD much more rapidly than others. So the therapeutics that have developed in this context, which consists of two drugs that have come onto the market recently, reduce the growth of geographic atrophy by around 20% over a two-year period, but they don't stop it. And also the treatments are invasive, with drugs being injected into the eye and carrying risks. So at this stage, there is little evidence that it functionally benefits patients to have this type of treatment. With regard to wet AMD, it's a completely different story. Wet AMD is a very sudden onset condition when there is bleeding and exudation into the key tissues of the macula. So these new blood vessels that have invaded the subretinal space and or sometimes the subretinal pigment epithelial space between the RP and Bruch's membrane. These blood vessels can bleed, they are fragile, and when this happens, the tissues in that region become very distorted, and as a consequence, visual function is affected dramatically. So most patients will either experience distortion of vision or they will experience sudden reduction vision. At that point, when treatment is given, we have a number of agents that can stop these blood vessels from leaking. The key therapeutic is an anti-vascular endothelial growth factor agent. So these drugs bind VEGF, which is the molecule that makes these blood vessels leaky. So by making the blood vessels competent and also in some instances inducing some regression of these vessels and preventing their growth by using these anti-VEGFs, we can make the symptoms a great deal better. So a patient who has dropped vision to around halfway down the Snellen's chart will find some improvement in their function when we stop this leak happening. So it's a very impressive treatment compared to what we used to have two or three decades ago when we used to use lasers to burn the blood vessels, when we also destroyed central site. So this change happened in 2007 with the introduction of these anti-VEGFs. And since then, we have developed algorithms to manage these patients with intravitreal injections of the anti-VEGF tailored to their need. And as a consequence, the rate of blindness due to AMD has reduced quite extensively across the world.
Do those anti-VEGF drugs have significant adverse effects?
In terms of ocular side effects, very, very limited risk. Very small proportions of patients will get an infection in the eye, but we take a lot of care in injecting these drugs into the eye, making sure that we inject them in a sterile, controlled fashion. So they are incredibly safe compared to a lot of other treatments. Over time, though, these drugs, while they don't cause acute side effects of importance, we still don't know whether they might worsen the risk of atrophy in the eye. It's possible, but at this time, the jury's still out because AMD itself causes atrophy, and introducing VEGF, which is a maintenance factor for the retinal pigment epithelium and the neurosensory retina, whether by blocking this, where question can arise whether they might in turn cause an increased degree of atrophy in these tissues.
I've been speaking today with Dr. Usha Chakravarthy about her recent JAMA review on age-related macular degeneration. Thanks for listening. This is Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA. For more of our podcasts, please visit us at jamanetworkaudio.com. You can subscribe and listen wherever you get your podcasts. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network.